Yeah, thank you for the introduction, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present our work here. So this, what you see here in the background of my title, is actually an artist's impression on non-equilibrium or universal dynamics for an article we wrote for Physics Journal, the DPG journal, last year. And I hope you already see a lot of this conference's topics here. I mean, there's certainly disorder. There's maybe some topological defects, and most likely here in this region where it's very calm, there's most likely also some hydrodynamics going on. So let me start by saying that I today will present work that I did in the labs of Markus Oberthaler, and mostly together with these guys down in the lab. And now I'm postdoc with Jörg Schmidmeier here in Vienna. So I would have like definitely enjoyed being at the Schrödinger Institute this week. But anyway, it's a great workshop this week. So let me start by giving you a general idea. So we are all interested in many body systems, and on the experimental side, many people try to engineer a large many body quantum systems on the single particle level, controlling every position and potentials and interactions. But I want to show you another approach to this. And the approach is to zoom out a bit. So come from the large scales and look if there are some, we want to see if there are still on the large scale, some emergent phenomena like these large spins emerging out of the soup of small interacting spins confined to some external potential. And so to show these ideas side by side, what I want to look at today is like if there is emergent degrees of freedom from these underlying particles, and if there is maybe also effective field theories capturing the description of these systems. Okay, so that's what I want to focus on today. And now I will show you first our experimental platform, then I will move on to our ideas concerning effective field theories and how to extract them from experimental observations. We'll show you some results on universal dynamics far from equilibrium. In the end, I want to show you some new data, which is still in preparation, which concerns the final thermalization of our experimental system. And I hope that I can show you some interesting data concerning that. So let me start by the experimental platform that we have in the labs of Markus Oberthaler in Heidelberg. So what we are dealing is we have a Bose-Einstein condensate of rubidium 87, which is confined in one dimension by an optical dipole trap. We capture around 100,000 atoms depending on the experimental details. And the dipole trap potential is quite essential here, because what we want to do is we want to do spin physics. So we want to trap more than one single hyperfine state and want to look at the internal degrees of freedom. So what you can imagine is you have this one-dimensional cloud, and when you go there and again take the microscopic view, then this is per typical imaging volume that we have within our spatial resolution, there are like 100 or 200 atoms which all inhibit like a small spin one particles. And then what we see experimentally is just the sum of all these. So they make up like a coherent sum of small little spins and add up to this large spin, which we also call sometimes a quantum field. And that's why we also try to bring this together with concepts from quantum field theory. So what we then can do experimentally is we can look at this spin degree of freedom. And in the regime where we prepare our experiment, and I will go into a bit more detail later, the relevant degree of freedom is a transversal spin. So this is a spin which is orthogonal to the homogeneous bias field that we have in the background. And this transversal spin degree of freedom, this is connected to coherences of the MF substates of our rubidium atom. So this is due to relative phase relations between the atom's MF states. And this we have to assess experimentally, although we are just measuring densities experimentally, as you most likely know. So what we have to do is radio frequency manipulation of the atoms to map transversal spin degrees of freedoms onto measurable densities and density differences. And then what we can do is we can detect these atoms by using light and some optics, which is not obviously not shown here. And then in the end, the CCD camera where we get an image of the light intensity on in the plane of the atoms. And from this, we can reconstruct the atomic density. And we can reconstruct the atomic density of all 8 hyperfine substates that we have in the rubidium electronic ground state. And I cannot go into details, unfortunately, here. But what you have to believe me is that from these type of manipulations and measurements, we can reconstruct this transversal spin degree of freedom in a spatially resolved fashion. And we can not only get one projection, but we can get 2 projections of this complex value transversal spin field in a single experimental realization by making use of generalized measurements, which we summarized in these 2 publications here, and which was the main work of my colleague, Philip Kunkel, who is now with Monica Slayer-Smith in Stanford. And we actually also have shown recently, this is the second publication here, that even though we are bringing in, because of these operations for this generalized measurements, some additional noise, we can still detect entanglement with these generalized measurements in these extended spin systems. So if you're interested, please have a read here. I hope that you can get some details about this from these 2 publications. Okay, what we then obviously have to do is we have to make sure that we can prepare the system in a stable way, that we can reproduce the experimental parameters oftentimes, and then we can take some statistics. And we have, and with that statistics, what we can do is we can, for example, throw all the spatial points together and all the realization and make, for example, these nice 2-dimensional histograms. And what you see is this ring-like structure. So we end up in a state where we have like nearly like well-defined spin length, but the phase overall shots and all spatial positions is random. And how this comes about is, this is what I want to show you next. So this is the general idea of our experiments. And this is the 3 topics I want to show you and what we probe with the experiment. So the idea is that you prepare some initial condition, which is far out of equilibrium, which is maybe a bit more close to equilibrium. And in the end, for long times, what you expect is that your system equilibrates. But the hope was that there might be some universal stages in between the equilibrium state and the far from equilibrium initial conditions, which are connected to so-called non-thermal fixed points. But let me start by showing you how we prepare this initial condition and how we observe the emergence of an emergent, let me call it relevant degree of freedom. So what we can do is we can prepare all the atoms in this MS equal to 0 substate. And this looks in this 2-dimensional histograms where I'm plotting the fx and the fy component and just making these histograms. This looks like this. So this is like a small blob with no well-defined spin length and just like coherent state fluctuation around 0. What I can now do is I can now do a quench. And this quench, in a quite classical picture here, you can imagine as preparing this little classical ball on the unstable fixed point of this Mexican head potential. And we do this by changing some magnetic field and making this control parameter here close to 0. And now I will show you an animated figure, what happens to this distribution. So what you see is like this fast explosion, like you expected from rolling down the hill of this little ball. And then the experiment or like the system settles in the rim of this Mexican head potentials and leads to a well-defined spin length, but overall a random phase. And now you can say, oh, system is already finished, it's thermalized, it's down in the rim. But that's not true. There is still dynamics going on. And to analyze the dynamics, what we have to do is we have to look at the spatial distribution of these transversal spin values, which our system allows us to do. So what we can do is we can measure the value of this transversal spin field at 2 different positions. And then, for example, calculate correlation functions. 2-point correlation functions, which we can then, for example, Fourier transform to get this in momentum space. And our spatial resolution is quite nice. And we can get a lot of momenta over some range. And especially it's nice to measure in real space here because we are interested in low momentum physics, so in infrared physics. And this is always hard to do with like usual time of flight experiments. So it's nice that we can measure this transverse spin field in real space. And then what we can do is we can go for higher order correlation function, which was actually pioneered also here in Vienna at the Atom Institute where I'm sitting now. So, and then we came up with the idea and thought about like, can we extract maybe some effective action for our system? So can we get some information from these correlation functions, which is maybe more above like beyond saying just that it's a non-Gaussian system. And this was work that we have done in collaboration with Jürgen Berges and his PhD student at this time, Thorsten Zappel. And there was also related work going on here in Vienna with Jörg Schmiedmeier and Sebastian Erne. This is summarized in these two publications. So the questions are, is there an effective field theory for new relevant degrees of freedoms? And can we access and identify those experimentally? And I can just give you a glimpse here today because like, as you see, my time is limited, but I anyway want to give you like an idea of what we did. So, okay, now this zoom bar is there, but I think there is shown. So the quantum effective action is something that you can derive or usually derive in quantum field theory from your underlying microscopic theory by doing some Legendre transformation, and then you derive an effective field theory for the expectation value of the field. And you can expand this, and the expansion coefficients are the so-called one particle irreducible correlation functions. And the idea in this work was, can we extract them experimentally? And is there something you can learn about the experiments from that? And yes, you can extract them. So the first term, like a mass term, this is just like the two-point correlation function. And this gamma two is just the inverse of the usual two-point correlation functions that you calculate. And now you have to ask the question, how do we get this interaction-like term, which is like a fourth order 1PI correlation function? Because if you just calculate the fourth order correlation function connected, what you can easily do from our experiments, you see that is not exactly that object what you want to have. So this is like a Fuhrman's version of a Feynman diagram describing this four point vertex here. And I think there are most likely more expertise people here in the round than me, but I want just to give you this graphic illustration for showing you what we did. So the four-point correlation function has these additional legs here attached to it. So what we have to do is we have to amputate them in a sense. And experimentally, this is given by dividing out these two-point correlation functions, which we anyway have calculated. So what I want to show you is that we can do this experimentally and access these degrees of freedom. And these correlation functions, sorry. So interestingly, so now you have a way to look at these objects, but now you're standing there because like this is a four-dimensional object, and now you ask, how do I plot this if I want to publish it in this boring two-dimensional papers? So what you can do is you can look at, for example, you can look at slices. So you can set two of the momenta to zero and look at how these objects depend on the two other momenta P1 and P2. And what we see is this diagonal structure. And this diagonal structure tells you that there is some momentum conservation going on. So this is exactly the diagonal where P1 is equal to P2, okay? So we observe some momentum conserving structure in these objects. So but what you can do now is you can show this not only one tile, but you can like look at the whole plaquette of those. So what you see is now like different first momenta fixed as a function of P3 and P4. And what you can see is if you go like one momentum to the left with one of the indices, you see that this diagonal shifts. Because in this plaquette, the momentum conserving diagonal is one shifted. And you see overall this structure. What you see also for larger momenta, there is no signal anymore. And what I did not tell you up to now, that this is not a signal, but this is actually the statistical significance of this data. So what I want to show you here is that this is something which is really hard to obtain experimentally because you need a lot of statistics to obtain them in a well-controlled manner. So this is definitely a future challenge to observe these at higher momenta. But what you can now do is you can, for example, look at one of these plaquettes, this central one, and look really at the momentum dependence. And what we found is that in a far from equilibrium situation, we see that this four-point correlator, which is associated with some kind of interaction constant, is strongly dependent on momenta. So you have a strong reduction of interaction strength at low momenta, which was actually somewhat anticipated for this non-equilibrium phenomena. And in the details, I'm happy to talk about these, but you can also find in a paper, because what Thorsten has shown is that also for this equal time effective action parameters, there is a Boltzmann equation describing the evolution of these equal time correlation functions. And this is the momentum dependent coupling constant in this Boltzmann equation. So this was nice to see, and this is a way, and I hope this is also a future way to analyze and to characterize these emergent phenomena far from equilibrium. Okay, so I now showed you that we can prepare these initial conditions and interesting states and how we might identify some emerging structures in our experimental data. So now let me come to the next point, the non-thermal fixed point and the universal dynamics. So what's the idea here? So first, let me say, this was done in collaboration also with Jürgen Berges, Christian Marcel Schmid and Thomas Kasenza, all from Heidelberg. And there was like two publications at this time, back to back, so our experiment in Heidelberg and an experiment here in Vienna, the group of Jörg Spielmann. So what's the idea? So let us focus on the right side. At this non-thermal fixed point in the universal regime, what you expect is that some observable, that you have some macroscopic observable in the infrared, takes up a universal shape. And this shape does not change anymore in the dynamics. And all what happens is that this typical length, for example, this typical length scale and this typical amplitude scale changes in time. And it changes with a power law in time, with t to the beta and t to the alpha. So what this means is that this dynamics is fully characterized in this observable in the infrared by these two exponents, alpha and beta, and the shape of this function. So what we observed experimentally is the following. On the left side, you see the structure factor, which is something like a power spectrum of the transversal spin as a function of time going from here, this bluish color to red. And what you see is exactly what we anticipated. We see a shift to the left and we see a shift upwards of the amplitudes. And what you can do now is you can look for values of alpha and beta to rescale this data. And if there is a universal scaling behind this, all the data should collapse onto one universal function. And this is indeed what we find. So the data collapses onto a universal function. So what we have identified with this is that there is a regime in the dynamics of this quantum many body systems that I can describe solely by two exponents, alpha and beta, which are actually connected. So there is something like one exponent and this universal scaling function. And we can see and experimentally probe, and I have not the time to show you that this phenomenon is actually independent of initial conditions and microscopic details. Okay, and this is something which is reminiscent and which reminds you maybe of the universality classes, which you maybe know close to equilibrium or close to phase transitions. And I will now show you what the result is. So the result of our work is that we find, for example, this exponent beta to be 0.54. The Vienna experiment, then there was some numerics. Let me come first to this. There was now some numerics in O3 and O1 symmetric models, which also find beta as 1/2. Then Christian Marcel Schmid and Thomas Kasenza did some numerics for the spin one system in purely 1D, and they find 0.25. So you already see that there is now a second exponent coming up. So it's not clear that there's just one universal exponent. There might be a class of exponents and so on. Then there was a Vienna experiment which found 0.1 in a single component gas. Like in the following 2 years, there was also more experiments. For example, there was like observations with vortices in the group of Helmerson in Australia, which found some anomalous slow exponent of 1/5, and experiments by Zoran Hatzibabic in a homogeneous box gas, which was more like a 1/3. And there was even new simulations with magnonic excitations And most likely there is many more numerics, and hopefully soon also experiments. And the hope in the future, and that's what I want to pursue and want to find out, and all my collaborators as well, is there really some structure, and is there really some universality classes which are well defined, and what are the defining parameters, and how can you experimentally establish also this phenomenon. Okay, I have another 15 minutes, right? Perfect.
So to make sure, you have another 10 minutes and then questions.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, 10 minutes is perfect. So I now showed you initial conditions, non-thermal fixed point, and now what is open is equilibrium. So can we go to close to thermal equilibrium with our system? This was not clear at all to us. Can we go first? What is the nature of this thermal ground state? And can we do it in experimentally accessible timescales? Okay, so this was our last study, which again with Jürgen and his PhD student Daniel. And this is now preliminary data that I show you. This is still in preparation. And some of the plots are really from last week, where we first compared theory and experiment. So what we did, because we hope that it helps us studying the thermalization, and because it's fun anyway for the experiment, we made this BEC homogeneous. So what we did is we did the most simple ansatz. We just plugged some end caps on our one-dimensional potential, and with this cut out like the most homogeneous part. And you see here, this is the total density of this BEC. Okay. So what we can also do, and this helps us a lot here, we can now tune the size of our condensate. Yeah, we can make it larger if we want to follow the dynamics for a long time and want to see the universal dynamics. But we can also make it a bit smaller, such that the system takes less time, what we found out, to go close to thermal equilibrium, because the transport earlier hits like the system size, in a sense. So let me shortly discuss the Hamiltonian with you that we can together understand the ground state properties. So what we have is like a density-density interaction term. So we have like these three MF components, and each MF components interact with itself, but there is also cross interaction between the components. So this would lead, for example, if you would prepare all the atoms here, and if this MF is equal to zero state, to a single component condensate in one of the components, fixing like the total phase. But then there is like small differences in the scattering length. Unfortunately, they are really small in rubidium, leading to small interaction energies. But this leads to the existence of this spin-spin interaction term, which is going with this parameter C1. And C0 and C1 are like a factor 200 different in our system. And then as a third parameter, there's Q, which is the difference of these three MF states in energy. So the difference between zero and plus and minus one. And going to a regime where like the interaction energy according to C1 and Q are in the same order, the ground state of this thing is not only a condensate and the total density, but it's also like an elongated spin in the transversal spin plane. So it's really like this Mexican head potential that I showed you earlier. And it's a spontaneous symmetry broken state in this situation. So that motivated us to look for the emergence of long-range coherence in the spin. And how did we do this? We did this quite, let me say, in a classical way. So we looked at the G1 function, so at the coherence function, first-order coherence function of this complex value transversal field. So we calculated F perp star at x times F perp at x plus delta x. And this is the result. So here here as an inset, you see the two-dimensional distribution, but here's a cut. And this cut shows you the correlations between the left edge of the cloud compared to the same point and going all the way to the right edge. And what you see that for short times, which are shown in blue, this function decays very fast, over a third of the system size. But in the course of the dynamics going to the orange color here, coherence is built up such that we find a finite coherence over the whole range of the system. So we now here at this point, we really correlate the left and the right edge of the cloud, of this homogeneous cloud. And we find a finite coherence between these two systems. So we really see the emergence of long range coherence or off diagonal long range order, I don't know, like as you wish, in this spin system. You can also see this, for example, in the condensate fraction, which is something like the zero momentum of this power spectrum of this thing here. And you see a stark rise here in the dynamics, and then it settles to a constant value, which is associated with this long range coherence. This was nice. We were happy because this is already nice because now we have a spin system which has like coherence and is stable there. It does not change anymore. I mean, we can also prepare a spin, just a coherent elongated spin, but this is not stable. So this is shown here. This has still to evolve. So now in the remaining 4 minutes, perfect. I will explain you what we expected and how we probed the ground state properties. So what do you expect to have here as underlying quasi-particles, for example? Yeah, what are the quasi-particle energy dispersion relations that you expect? So as I already said to you, we expect a ground state which has the spontaneous symmetry breaking of this phase degree of freedom, which is associated to the Lamar phase. So you have like a spontaneous symmetry breaking of the Lamar phase of this spin phase. Then you have, due to this F square term here, you have an explicit symmetry breaking of the so-called spin-off phase, which is something like the phase of the MF is equal to zero component, which tells you you have a spin and no quadrupole, for example. So you have an explicit symmetry broken, a symmetry which is explicitly broken. So, and then there is another symmetry which is the total phase, and there you find also a spontaneous symmetry broken in the ground state. So, and what you can expect from this is that you find free dispersion relations of some underlying quasi particles. Two of them are linear plus quadratic, some typical Bogoliubov modes, and have totally different energy scales. So the speed of sound differs by a factor of 14 because of the difference in these interaction scales. And then you find a gapped mode, which is quadratic, which is on the same order as the spin in energy scales. So how can we probe this? How can we see if there's really like these modes? So what we do is we use the type of local control given by an acousto-optical deflector that we have, and we imprint local perturbations into the system. The first thing is what we do, we imprint a Gaussian wave packet on top of the Lamar phase. So we really change in a spatially varying manner the Lamar phase of this system. And what we see is that this wave packet here does not disperse, but it splits into two wave packets with move with a constant speed of sound, which you can see here. Yeah, we nearly see no decay of this amplitude, okay? So what we then do is we excite the total density degree of freedom. We just excite the total density. And what we see is that the wave packet, which is here already slightly split, also splits up into two wave packets, which are moving with a speed of sound. But now the speed of sound also experimentally is quite different. So this is the black line, which is fitted to the spin speed of sound. And this is shown here. So you see in the time where the total density moved quite like over the total system, the spin would not move at all. So you really see that these 2 degrees of freedom have different energy scales. And when we then excite this gapped mode or something which is associated with this gapped mode, what we find is that the wave packet just disperses as you expected from a mode which has a gap and quadratic spectrum. And you see the integral of this thing is actually staying constant. And we can also excite the k is equal to zero mode and nicely see the oscillation. So this motivates us, let me come to my last point. This motivates us to look at the theoretical descriptions and maybe get some thermal expectation. So what we can do with this Hamiltonian is we can expand this around the mean field ground state in second order and do a Bogoliubov transformation for this spin one system, which is nicely done, for example, also here. And then what you get is you get exactly these three modes. I mean, it's the same plot, but you can also anticipate it just from thinking about the physics. And what you can now do is you can look at the energies. And the energies are totally different. So the spin and the gap are on the scale of 1 hertz. And the energy density, the energy of the density degree of freedom is on the order of 150 or 200 hertz. Okay. And now we wondered, can we fit or can we get a thermal expectation with just one temperature describing the system for all these three different modes? So, and this is what we done. So we measured here in red this is the power spectrum of the transversal spin field. So this is now really now preliminary data where I just tell you what I did and not claiming anything, but I just show you what we compare and what we find out. So what we find is these experimental spectra. So we find this power spectrum as a function of K. And on top, what you see is you see a fit of the thermal expectation, which has some temperature, which is something like 80 Hertz, and some microscopic parameter for the interaction density. So we found, oh, this is, we were quite happy that we can fit that. But in a sense, this tells you that this is just consistent. But what we did is we measured other observables. We measured, for example, not only the transversal spin, but also the longitudinal spin, or measured the density-density correlations of the single MF components. And what we find that we can fit all of these observables and the spectra with like one thermal expectation with the same temperature and the same microscopic parameters. And I hope that we can make this solid and understand the parameters to really show that we are going close to some thermal equilibrium state here with this, or at least are consistent with some thermal description here of this spin one system. Okay. So, and I'm happy for some questions and feedback then afterwards. So let me shortly give an outlook what we plan to do here also in Vienna with Jörg Schmidmann. So one thing we are very curious about is like the connection between this effective action that we measured and for example, the microscopic or some effective Hamiltonians. And this is something we want to definitely have a look at. Then a question which is bothering us all is like, how is this universal dynamics, which we associate with the non-thermal fixed point, how is this connected to other universal phenomena like coarsening, turbulence, or these equilibrium universality classes, for example? And as a last thing, we are also interested in measuring, for example, unequal time correlation functions to get another view on this thermalization process with fluctuation dissipation relations, for example, in the different regimes of the thermalization. Okay, so with this, I let you with my final slide and thank you for your attention and happy about your questions.